Welcome back. We're here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Our guest today is Carol Issac. And currently we're talking about prompting, a very, very important part of the opera house. But for a moment, I'd like to play the devil's advocate.
Okay.
In today's opera, the singers are so well educated, they're so well prepared most of the time. Mm-hmm. Do we really need that person in the box?
I say yes. And I say yes because the performances that have prompters are always better. If you have a good prompter in the prompter's box, the performances are always better.
When you say better, what is better? They sing better?
They can sing better if you're a good prompter because they're singing with confidence. They're not panicking. The ensemble hopefully will be better. The energy can be better. Everything can be better with a prompter. The other issue here is that singers don't always speak the language, and if the role is extremely long, they need help. There are so many words to memorize. And the other thing is, don't forget that they're not saying it, they're singing it. The effort to sing is enormous. It takes a lot of physical energy, and they're thinking about their technique. And very often they go up on the words, and as they're thinking, I'm not going to make it through this phrase, they will forget the next phrase.
Right.
And you have to know, they're nervous about the end of this phrase, I'm going to be right there with the next words, you know?
So in other words, you really give them the security.
Security. Yeah. Also, we have a lot of singers who come at the last minute these days because of travel, airplane travel, and everyone's calendars get more full and more full and more full. Instead of less full, obviously.
Also cancellations. Singers cancel at the last minute.
Constantly. And you know there have been people that have never set foot on the Met stage before. And if they have a prompter, they're going to sing confidently.
They'll be relaxed.
Yes.
Well, you
and
convinced me, but
well, there
you
are
didn't
also
mean to do much to convince me.
Yeah. Listen, there are also conductors, of course, who won't work without one. They won't work without one. And there are conductors who think they don't need one. They don't, they're not used to them. And they think I don't need it. But I will say that usually they're wrong.
You sound convincing, and I hope optimistic that it's not. One sees a trend that more and more the prompter is being left out, but you're optimistic that that will not happen to the world of opera.
I actually don't see it. I see that the Metropolitan Opera still has one, Chicago, San Francisco, Scala. I mean, there may be some houses in Europe that are starting to do away with it, but believe me, the prompters, the repertoire I have seen that should have a prompter that don't have one, the performances are usually middling to dreadful, I would say. And that opera house then should be ashamed of itself for letting the composers suffer.
Do you think that's sort of a bias talk?
On my part?
Yeah.
No. No.
That word, no, is a bias.
It's probably bias talk. But listen, the visual is very important these days, and I understand that. Visual is important to me, too. If I see something that's boring, it's not terrific. But I don't see that there shouldn't be a prompter. Why should there not be a prompter? What is the problem with having a prompter? Is it the sight line? The sight line of that tiny little box at the front? That's silly.
We hear that set designers want their set made so that there's not a smooth without a box, but with a little creativity, they can put a little bump in the front of the stage.
Yes. That's a little arrogance, I would say, because, you know, I had a director say to me once, you know, I don't know why you're here. I don't need you as an assistant. And I looked at him and I said, heads up, I'm not your assistant. I'm his assistant.
Exactly.
The conductor's assistant. Yeah.
So at the end of a performance, there must be a great feel of satisfaction when do you stay in the box while the singers take their bow and do you?
Yes. Sometimes I have to because I'm trapped by the orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
I can't get out.
So I'm sure, and I've seen it myself, of course, that they will acknowledge you during the bows. And that must be a good feeling.
That's enormous. You know, you have to stay there almost 4 hours or 5 hours.
Yes.
Then, even.
Yes. Well, you can, during the break, you can go and have a,
oh, yeah,
a washroom.
But still.
Still, it's concentration.
It's not comfortable in that box.
No,
that.
It's hot, I will
it's
say.
It's hot. Yes. It's small and you can't.
Yes. And they spit on you.
You can't,
you know,
have claustrophobia.
They're singing in this. No, no.
No, no.
Do you think you can have some kind of a, you know, exercise machine where you were doing it and you're just doing that?
While I'm prompting?
That's right. When you can help yourself in the same time?
Well, I'm actually, my feet are moving while I'm prompting because what my feet are doing is tapping myself the orchestral beat as opposed to the singer's beat. I have to constantly keep my body on orchestra time. And I don't like to do that with my hands because that confuses them. Then they see two conductors, and that's not good.
Right.
I use my hands a lot as a prompter, mm-hmm. but it's always this motion for, please don't sing now. And then I'll count them down, how many bars they have.
Right.
4, 3, 2, as you do a television here. And then I'll give them the entrance with my hands. And often I have to use two hands if there's a few singers. You know, I'm getting them ready, you know.
Right.
Are you able to enjoy a performance doing all this, or you enjoy the doing of what you're doing? But can you say, oh, Bohème tonight, I really enjoyed as a performance?
That's really wonderful.
Yes. I mean, of course, it has to be for me like a putting a puzzle together. I'm working, and it's not my job to sit back and enjoy it. I'm getting paid. So because I'm getting paid, I have to be there every second for every singer. But when I hear something good, I'm telling you, it's the best seat in the house.
Mm.
You know, today, for example, I just came here from work and I heard Bryn Terfel sing the Act 3, Scene 1 scene from Siegfried, and I just thought I was going to die. It was so good.
And you got paid to
hear that. And I got paid to hear him sing that. It's shocking, isn't it?
Besides you getting paid,
mm-hmm.
You must get some kind of a satisfaction. You mean rewarding. Afterwards, he said, I really did a wonderful job.
Yes, and also I flog myself if I make a mistake, because me making mistakes, it happens, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And if I do, I'm just like, you know, I remember in detail the mistakes I've made, and mm-hmm. terrible.
Did you do that, like, you know, if you miss a little bit something, you can't sleep at night?
Sure.
Yes?
It takes me hours to get to mm-hmm. sleep. I'm like, I can't believe I did that, and I'll practice it over and over and over. Yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm. This gets back to what you said at the very beginning, that we are studio mates or partners. We share a studio at the Met, and
mm-hmm.
Carol practices more than anybody else,
because
you are also a wonderful pianist, so you practice the piano a lot. I have a question for you. Who do you count as your, do you have a principal mentor with prompting or coaching that you give credit to?
Well, my high school music teacher, as I said, was the first one I had, yeah? Then I had a wonderful singing teacher in Toronto, who's the one that I think knew before I did that I should be working with singers.
Did you study singing yourself?
Yes, when I was young, but not long, you know.
But I mean serious vocal, you had a
serious vocal
mm-hmm.
lessons, yes, in high school I did, but then I sort of gave it up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I gave it up. I didn't think, yes, I know. Probably, I probably knew I was no good.
Mm-hmm.
But the singing teacher, Mary Morrison, sort of said, now come and hear this singer, come and hear this singer. And she, sometimes, you know, if she had a student who wasn't so good, she would use a lesson for my benefit. She would say, now, Carol, listen to this. Now, Carol, listen to this. And she would try different things, and she trained my ear to listen to a sound in different ways. I credit her with a lot. And my Russian piano teacher was one of the biggest influences on me. A wonderful piano teacher named Boris Lysenko. He lives in Toronto now, from Leningrad. And of course, there's some conductors that I consider my mentors, a lot of Czech conductors that I just think they really helped me. I loved Sir Charles Mackerras too, just thought he was terrific. But I would say now, the person a mentor, I don't know, but a person I think highly of is James Levine. I just can't get over that talent. It's just incredible.
Right.
Yeah. You've worked with him so much more than I have. It's just incredible.
Yes, he's in a class of his own.
Yeah.
But never, I'd say, a prompter mentor, one person that sort of taught you how to prompt.
I never studied it.
You never? Well, it's not something one studied. There's not a major in a conservatory for a prompter.
No. And you know, Dennis, the first time I ever prompted, I didn't know what it was. I was in Vancouver, and we were doing Metropolitan case, oddly enough. And the soprano said to the company, I love her, I am not going on unless you put her in a box and she prompts me, because he doesn't cue me. That's what she said, my friend Mary Jane. And they said, okay, we'll build you a box, we'll put Carol in it, but I didn't know what I was supposed to do. So I went to my boss, I said, what am I supposed to do? I'd never seen a prompter. And he said, oh, well, you know, when you're in rehearsal and you're playing for me, and she makes a mistake and you hold your hand up and then you get her back in, that's what you have to do. I thought, oh, okay, well, I
that's
can do
easy.
That. That's easy.
I can do that.
I can do that. So, you know, it was just I got thrown in the box and I just sort of did it. And I would ask my, and this woman, this soprano, Mary Jane, she was the one who said to me before she ever asked for me to be in the box, you're a prompter. You have a prompter's personality. Prompter's personality, I asked her, what is that? She said, it has to be a person who adores singers, which I do, but it has to have a personality of different sides, like a cheerleader, a disciplinarian.
A psychiatrist.
Psychiatrist.
You definitely have to have a compassion.
Huge.
Yes.
For him and for them. And they say, who do you side for more, the conductor or the singer? And without sounding terrible, the answer is whoever is better. Is that a terrible thing to say? I've worked with some really good conductors. I know that the singers want to be with the conductor. But if, and of course that's my first job. I shouldn't say it's not. But if the singer sounds fantastic and they want to spend a little extra second on that high note, who am I to tell them to come down? Well,
at the Met currently,
maybe I'm wrong.
The majority of the prompters are female. There are much fewer men prompting. Now, is there a reason for that, in that the higher voice is heard better on by the stage, or why do we?
I don't know, Dennis. I mean, actually, the prompters I've known in the past have been men.
Mm-hmm. It seems
Jonathan
like in the past there
Philip.
Were more men, but today there are
yes,
more
you're
women
right.
prompting.
And you're absolutely right.
I don't know which voice type carries, like you want it to carry to the singers, but not to the audience.
That's right.
There's a difference between men and women's voice.
There's a way also to get the word to the singer without saying the entire word very loudly. If the word is schweige, you could say schweig, and they get the beginning of the word and they're in, you know.
What's the most difficult opera? Not talking about the situation, I know it's dependent on who's singing and where it is and everything, but just purely from the opera, what is the most difficult opera you've ever prompted?
You just mentioned that you say, I almost want to give up something.
Meistersinger was difficult, but actually Siegfried, I'm doing right now, this is a hard opera to prompt because there are so many little pitfalls and so many extra bars and all the motives come at different times and they all sound different. I like to be a prompter who's memorized myself. If they have to memorize, I should have to memorize. Why should I be staring at my book? This is rude. The end of Act Two of Meistersinger is the... How long does that take?
Much shorter time than you think it takes.
It takes months to learn, and it flies by in seconds. This is the most difficult scene I've ever prompted. I would say a show like, for example, Wozzeck is difficult to prompt, and Lulu and things like that.
Because of simply the complexity of the music.
Yes, and how difficult it is for them. Mm-hmm. And anything could happen in the orchestra. I know that they have the music in front of them, but they miss cues too. They're human as well. Mm-hmm. So if they miss a cue that the singer is relying on, and then everybody starts getting off, do you know what happened once in Vancouver? It was Salome, and the contrafagot's supposed to come and play do 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 do, and he missed the cue one night, and the whole orchestra comes back in by counting from his cue because he missed his cue. There was dead silence in the orchestra. And the singers looked at me, and I sang a pitch, and I, hi, and chang, and she's supposed to sing or something like that, and I cued her. And then all the Jews seen, there are five Jews in that opera that sing a canon, and they all came in, and I prompted them, and the stage got the orchestra back on. Mm-hmm. It's the first time in history for me that that's ever happened.
Has there been an opera where you totally lost it, where things just absolutely fell apart and you turned off your light and said...
I've never turned off my light, but I've just gone, oh my God, it's too late, it's too late. And that was the end of the second act of Meistersinger. You know, if the chorus is not bang on in that, and if the Meisters are not bang on, I mean, it is a cacophony. And then you're counting the bars, and you know who you need to get in, and time passes, and eventually you get the people in for the end of the act, and that's about it.
Now, we're going to jump to, you know, you coach a lot.
Yeah.
And you teach.
And I play, yes, exactly.
So, how do you like to coach singers?
I love doing that. Mm-hmm. And especially now I start liking to, enjoying the young singers who come, and they are so excited about singing and giving the students some advice. I just did that last night. Yeah. And I adore coaching. I just love it.
It's what the do one-on-one?
Right.
Yes, it's the one-on-one thing, isn't it, Dennis? It's the one-on-one where you can really make a difference. And they can get so excited and so inspired then. Also, I love playing for rehearsal. That's also wonderful.
What do you teach? I mean, exactly. I mean, coach-wise.
Well, it depends on what the singers need. Uh-huh. I mean, if they need to learn a role quickly, you need to teach them that role quickly. You need to know how to teach them that role quickly. Mm-hmm. But if they're having trouble with a certain singing aspect or any language issues, mm-hmm. for Czech, I get a lot of people coming to me for Czech.
Or style.
Style. Mm-hmm. Portamenti and things like this,
right.
Yes. It totally depends on the singer. Mm-hmm. And I often ask them, what do you want to work on? Mm-hmm. I'm not one of those people who starts coaching and runs the show. I say, what do you want from me? If they don't have an answer, then I dive in and I do my thing.
Right.
But I always respect them. I need to learn this in 3 days. I go, okay. No finesse here. This is the rhythm. These are the words.
Do you prefer that singer come to you and they prepared or not?
I've had both instances, and I actually enjoy both, unless the singer comes to start rehearsal and they haven't even cracked the score. Then the pressure is on me to teach them that score so that the director can work with them. And that's never fun. That's never
no,
fun.
At your level, that's not what you're supposed to be doing.
But there are times the singers feel like this is the way it should be. And I like this way. And you think this is wrong. What do you do in that moment?
Do you mean if a singer says this is how I like to do it?
Yeah.
I say, well, absolutely fine. We'll see what the conductor thinks about that.
I see.
Pass the buck. It's always the best thing.
And you don't try to correct them.
I will if it's wrong, but if it's a question of interpretation or something, it's not my job. I will say, well, there are various ways you could do this way. I give them all the options. They say, I prefer this way. They're the singer.
Right.
They're the ones who are the artist. I'm just a little plebeian.
But there are times you're talking about, okay, teaching, mm-hmm. coaching, mm-hmm. and vocal-wise. Mm-hmm. Do you do that?
Oh, if they're having trouble vocally, like if they're flat or something?
Right.
I say... My rule is you're not allowed to bring up anything in a coaching unless you can fix it. If you know how to fix it, go ahead and bring it up. And I'm not one of those people who beats around the bush. I don't say, you know, the color is off on that note. I'm the kind of person who will, if I know the singer is sensitive, say, I'm so sorry, but that is flat. Are you aware that that's flat? You're having intonation problems here and here. Of course I say it gently. I'm not never insulting because I can't sing. How could I possibly insult them? But I'm honest with them. I say, this is flat and this note is sharp or something like that. If they're having technical problems, it's not my job as a coach to fix it. It's their teacher's job to fix a technical problem.
So you would
problem.
Say, perhaps this section you could take to your voice teacher.
Exactly.
Most singers today, just for clarification, have two. They have
That's
a
right.
voice coach and they have a voice teacher.
That's
and the
right.
voice teacher deals with the technical
yes.
part of singing, and the
support,
coach
breathing.
Deals with style, language,
yes.
everything else.
Yes, learning the role.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Now, you have a lot of very, you know, famous singers.
Yes.
And you are working with them. How do you feel at the time? Do you get, say, okay, should I tell them you should not doing that? You should not be doing that.
Oh, yes. You have to develop a rapport with the singer before you pounce. So as they trust you, you start to speak with them and they invite you in. I would never take an established singer and start giving them notes unless the conductor said, you need to give Mr. So-and-so or Miss So-and-so these notes. I will go to them and say, these are from the maestro. But I would never presume to pounce on a singer. I hope I'm not one of those people. They're all extremely gifted, and they're being pulled in so many ways. The director, costume designer, general director, conductor, coaches, they have notes, we call them. They're given notes every second of every day. So I would say that my job is to be a cheerleader when I can be a cheerleader, to show them that I'm enjoying it. Yeah. But I mean, I have been starstruck before. Who hasn't been? First time I ever worked with Domingo, I couldn't speak. You know, I actually couldn't speak. Mm. Just, oh my God.
We've spoken about two parts of your different things you do, and they're both sort of behind the scenes. We don't see you, that is prompting and coaching. But
yes.
There's something else you do a lot of, which is on the stage. That's playing for recitals.
Yeah.
That must be tremendously gratifying to get on the stage and be the performance,
sure.
Be half of it in this case.
Yes, yes.
So you enjoy that greatly?
I love doing it. And you know, as I started my solo piano career, then I sort of morphed into an accompanist, right, for singers. And I thought, I've given up solo piano. But then I went back and I started doing solo piano again. I surprised myself by doing Janáček's piano music and chamber music and things like that. And I put together those things. It's the only kind of solo playing I will do now is his music.
Right?
I don't feel comfortable with anything else. We don't have time to practice that stuff so much anymore. But chamber music I love. I love playing for singers, yes. But oddly enough, I love doing it. And I used to do more of it. But I feel more comfortable as a rehearsal pianist and as a prompter. Mm-hmm. I feel good playing a recital. There's about 5% of me that doubts I'm any good at. Well, probably 50% that I doubt.
From
I'm
what you
good.
Say, I would take that to mean you're not in the routine of it because you don't do it constantly like
exactly.
Someone who just does that.
Correct. Correct. So I would doubt myself constantly. Mm-hmm. Do you doubt yourself?
Oh, definitely.
Yes,
exactly.
I just think I'm
yes.
terrible.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you doubt yourself constantly?
I do.
Not when in the prompter's box.
I doubt myself all the time in the prompter's box, but I can't show it.
Right.
I can't show it. No. We're all filled with self-doubt. I mean, even though I'm a little plebeian worker, I still think of myself as having an artistic temperament. Yes.
On that note, we've been talking to Carol Issac. Thank you, Carol, for being with us. We're here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.
If you'd like to see more of us, please visit www.classictalk.tv and see you next time.